Hey, Kiini.
We're not gonna bet.
All right, Jay, you have to ask introspective, innovative questions. Did you meet everybody, Jay? Nicole, this is Jay. Liana, that's Jay. Okay, you remember Scott? You remember TJ?
Scott.
Oh, Scott. I'm calling Saul Scott. You remember TJ? Did you feel special?
I took it, Jay.
She was like sitting in my mouth for a minute too.
I very strategically
You know who reminds me of my dad, brother? Yeah, Frank.
reminds me of him a lot, like tall, lengthy, light skin, long red, you know? Same color as
long dread.
Great shirt to him, aren't it?
Really?
Well, not, I mean, they're like
kind of like this day.
Oh, you're so
profound.
Sorry.
I apologize for keeping you away.
Well, good afternoon. Good afternoon. We'd like to welcome you to Writing Matters with Our Own Hands. Self-empowerment through self-publishing. Excuse me. The program today will include a panel discussion on self-publishing, followed by a question and answer session. Poetry reading, and as well viewing of the exhibit Self-Mission, which is an exhibit of self-published and independently published magazines. Rent Play Magazine would like to open up this discussion with by quoting one of the publications of Kalamu Ya Salaam titled, Our Women Keep Our Skies From Falling. He says in the preface, writing these essays has been an intensely educational and qualitatively critical experience in my life effort to contribute to the ongoing defense and development of African Americans. That's the gist of what we'd like to delve into in this discussion. First, we can begin by having the panelists introduce themselves. I think they could do that best and let the audience know their endeavors in self-publishing.
I'm Leonard Guillory, and I think everybody can hear me. And I work with Cybersoul Star Labs. We create, design, maintain, and post web pages. And the way that relates to self-publishing is that anyone who wants to publish their works can, and through us, by providing us with their works, we'll post them on the internet.
Hi, I'm Kiini, Salaam-Co-Owner of
Yusuf, Rasheed, really a visual artist that just happened to write about what I'm involved in. And one of my objectives is inspiring myself and others to begin to define our own cultural perspectives. And published several independent pieces about visuals and written information, and also published magazine Artist Papyrus, which is a publication that artists are writing on their own works instead of having to be bound by others who don't have our best interests in mind.
Hi, I'm Barbara Bebee. I used to be the publisher of Raw Magazine. I don't do that anymore. I now publish Fist Magazine, which is an online magazine. It's an Afrocentric magazine, pretty much the same kind of editorial content as Raw, except it's online and a little bit harder than Raw. Get harder than Raw, but it is. And I publish books.
And also, before we begin the discussion, Ms. Bebee needs to
check
before the panel discussion will end. So, excuse me. would like to open up again with Kalambo's quote in mind. My first question would be, there are many different reasons why we self-publish, and there are many different needs that are met in self-publishing. What are some of the needs that you feel each, you know, whoever would like to take up this question, what do you think feel some of the needs are satisfied, that are satisfied by your publication? The need to spread information, the need to also be self-initiated.
When we started Replay, because we felt that there wasn't really any type of media that was addressing the type of issues that we wanted to address in the manner that we wanted to address them. I guess one of our letters of praise / criticism said that it was very self-concerned, that the magazine itself was very self-concerned. And it actually did come out of that, that we were artists who did not really have a space in which we thought our needs or our interests were being recognized, and so we decided to publish with the magazine. And now it's kind of ahead of us, whereas we started from an artistic perspective and never with a business foundation. And that, at the heart of it for us, is just the information, the actual art itself, or a space.
Needs that were met, that was the question, right?
The needs as they relate to the community, and what your publication or what yourself, what your entity satisfies?
When I was publishing Raw, I think the main thing that made people happy was having a magazine that was comprehensive, that looked nice, and that wasn't motivated by the advertising in terms of what the editorial content would be. A lot of the times, I think people feel like the editorial content is kind of tampered by whoever's paid for that inside cover ad and that backside cover ad. And so I think people were very happy to see that. That was typically the response we got from people, was that they were just happy to see the magazine, they were happy to see something that was very comprehensive. And of course they liked the price, it was $1. It was a big steal. So that's the need, I think, that we fulfilled.
Did you have advertisers?
Yeah, we did. We had advertisers. Yeah, we didn't permit any major corporate advertisers. Coke wasn't allowed, McDonald's wasn't allowed, cigarettes weren't allowed, alcohol wasn't allowed. And so because those things weren't allowed, you can talk about those companies. You see what I'm saying? But once those companies come in, magazines have a tendency to alter their content so as not to offend the people who are paying for the magazine. Mm-hmm.
Has there been any instances where they have people like Coke or organizations like Coke and McDonald's that interfere strongly with the content? Is it just that the magazine will change up or
you were offered,
is that pressure from the organization?
No, we were offered advertising, but we refused it. I mean, that was part of the advertising guidelines, so we wouldn't take money from certain companies because we already knew. I mean, it's pretty much standard in this business that depending on who's paying for the stuff, it depends on what you write. Mm-hmm. And so when we were offered, it wasn't actually Coke, they offered us Minute Maid, same thing. Mm-hmm. But the whole point is that once they were in, I knew it would be a matter of time before we could no longer write about, the dangers of drinking soda, that type of thing. So our whole point was just don't take the money at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the things is that this most definite that Barbara talked about that happens throughout the publishing industry, especially with African-American material, and it goes back even to slavery. It's like you can't really expect a slave master to give you access to information that's going to free you. You know, and many times when we have serious manuscripts that we want to be published by popular publishers, either they're going to alter the material or they're not going to do it at all where the salt loses its savior. And it's really a big issue because self-publishing is like starting out on the ground floor and learning how the system actually really works before you actually go into a large corporate entity that includes more than just oneself. But we talk about independent schools, having independent schools that really are not independent of black, like we say that they are or what they should be, especially when we have these popular books. And there are many types of programs inside of educational programs, just like there are programs inside of material that's printed by the popular media to continue, and what this program is, to continue to perpetuate actually what's going on in society. So we have an opportunity as independent publishers to create the information that we so desperately need that comes through our own psychological and spiritual sources and resources that will begin to give us the truth that we so desperately need and not his story. And it needs to occur not only, it needs to occur from one extreme of the information system to the other. And fortunately, the new desktop or self-publishing system has given us access to a technology that we can actually begin to do it, and at the same time set examples for others to do the same thing. There are many of us who are walking around with 3 or 4 books in our hands that our people so desperately really need when our children don't need it. And so before we can create this alternative to raise the generation that's actually really being raised to deal with the transition that's occurring, we were going to have to be more involved in this type of dialogue. At the same time, set the example that's definitely needed for us to begin to self-publish and at the same time come together to stand with, but we can assist each other. What we have to do it in a bigger way.
You touching on developing network organizations of independently produced publications.
Yeah, because as individuals, we can just do so much.
Right.
There's an African proverb that said, one straw is broken, but you put it out in the middle, you have this stick. And I think that we need to, look at the holistic idea as far as the African perspective, as far as coming together with our different talents. We create this reality. Instead of working in independent factors, but it starts with individuals. But necessarily, each individual has to bring something to the table.
Based in the philosophy of being independent and not going to the corporations to work for advertising money, what have been some of the ways that we have collaborated and sort of gone against the conventional flow and sort of, I guess, brought it back to the community and worked within other, I guess, progressive and conscious-minded independent in what ways? How far is this development going? How much do we rely on each other? How much do we help each other develop?
Are you asking individually or?
Well, I'm asking what has been done.
Yes.
How do we act in an independent way? How do we operate? What are some methods?
As far as resources?
Yes, for tapping resources.
I can say one is that we work together with Red Flag. Mm-hmm. I have, in the sense that Red Flag provides me HTML ready version of the publication, and we post it. So that's one real world up close example of working together, two independent entities working together to further get the information. And that's one way now. Now traditionally, I'm not sure as far as other types of publishers, in what areas that other people are networking, other types of publishers.
One thing that's really interesting that's just happened is Walter Mosley, who's obviously a best-selling author, agreed to have, or decided to have one of his earlier books published by an independent black publisher, which is Classic Black Books. I think, I'm not sure where they're based. Do you know where they are? But that's one, that's another thing that large black authors who already have money-making potential often say that they like to publish with black publishers or independent publishers, but. And I think this is a phenomenal thing that Walter Mosley has done, because it's kind of going to call a lot of writers on what they say. He said, okay, I'm almost an assured success. I don't need any more money, so I'm going to give this to a small publisher. He's wavered his advance, he's wavered the the international rights, the video rights, and audio rights to this publisher in a way of just basically saying, I think what small independent publishers are doing is important, and you know, I do what I can to further it. But I think we do need to find ways to network and resource, because I know we're almost tapped out in terms of energy. So.